Everybody wants to run away from him. They will say, ENT surgeons will send him to facial surgery. He will send it to dentist. He will send it to plastic. And ultimately, the patient just gets better and accepts that as a way of life. And that has been the story. And that goal is so ferocious that even the brave hearts run helplessly to offer. A ballet dancer cannot teach a cup. Is it purely submucous fibrosis? Are we dealing with just the pure submucous? It's not. It affects the muscles. If you have a chance to feel the muscle in an oral cancer patient who also has got submucous fibrosis, his muscles are all fibrous. There are hardly any muscles. The masseters are not as nice and soft and bulky, but they are a robust band of fibrous tissue. They are uninterrupted molars. You keep on talking. And roughly, and lastly, the very shallow anterior fossa. I did put it in the end, but when it comes to surgery, please remember, I have also put down an anterior fossa. That gentleman over there, do you think he's a happy man? He's a thoroughly unhappy person, although I opened up his system so much. And the reason was, his swallow was now affected. His tongue won't reach to the palate to push the food back because the tongue still remained anchored to the floor of the mouth by the submucous fibrosis. So it is a lot of hard work, a lot of things to understand. It is just not the retromolar fossa, it is just not the cheek. It is not just the floor, it's everything. In treatment, there are some red flags. Please be aware of it. And if your patient has got any of these symptoms, it means that the submucous fibrosis is no more a submucous fibrosis. Something else is happening. And of course, on this forum, something else is malignancy. Before you start getting into it, you have to start documenting, which is called medical auditing in these days. And the thing is, please do not grade your patient unless he has stopped the habit for 3 months. And I tell it from conviction, because if you see somebody with submucous fibrosis today and say, my God, he's grade 4, you ask him to stop the habit, and meanwhile he goes on homeopathy, you know, jelly booty, junani, whatever, and 3 months later, he comes a little bit better. I don't think the Yunani medicine has worked, neither the homeopathic has worked, but has worked the cessation of habit. And that is your beginning point. Supposing you didn't do this, you will get an over-inflated or over-successful rate, which are not really true. Now, I will take you through these various things which I did. In the beginning, as we all do, we take one step at a time. I was injecting, I was band dividing, I was grafting. And all these things I did, and I will tell you through how I progressed myself from one end to another. What did we have as surgical options once we divide the bands? We have split seam graft, we got wound graft, we have got tongue flaps, palatal flaps, fat flaps, nasolabial flaps, and the temporal fascia flaps. I just mentioned for condemnation about the seam flaps, the full thickness graft, and the band division. When I first acquired laser, I was in Indore, and I am grateful to these guys from Indore, particularly Dr. Bhargav and Dr. the other gentleman from Nagpur. And they called up a patient from the downstairs. He was at the pharmacy. They called Theka there. And this Theka fellow came up, and very impressively, they divided the bands with laser. No bleeding, no nothing. Patient opened her mouth a little bit better. I went downstairs very happy, thinking that, okay, this seems to be the thing. And while just getting into my taxi, I saw this guy in the pharmacy. I just went up to him and said, "Kaise lag raha aapko? Kya saab ye to hamesha ka hai? Koi bhi naya aadmi aata hai, mujhe upar bula lete, cut kar dete, main niche aa jata." So I realized that this was the sales gimmick tactic of the laser company and not the real thing. Therefore, I condemn this for mentioning it. Don't do it. Now, I share the experience of this particular technique, and he had done about over 300 cases, it's much more now, but I will share with you what I did in all these cases, and we will get to one by one. Let's talk about lateral tongue clamps. Now, before we go into technical details about the procedure I just mentioned, all these clamps are there to bridge the gap which you create in the cheek and the retromolar trigone as a result of opening up the trismus. Now, I started using tongue clamps because those were my early days, and free flaps had not come about in my cancer hospital where I was working. PMMC was very laborious, so nobody was willing to do it. and cheek reflex were easy to close by tongue flaps. I'm sure, see, a lot of people in the early days have used tongue flaps to close the cheek reflex. And I said, why not take that analogy and start working here? And I did that because it's a robust flap, but it has a problem. I have a patient who was about to get married and could not open his mouth, and needless to say, what purpose he came to me with when he wanted to have a nice wide opening mouth. I said, okay, I'll do it. We did it. We did tongue flaps. Thoroughly miserable patient. Although he could open his mouth, he had a bad pouch at the band which collected food and gave him a bad breath. At the same time, his speech got altered because sizable amount of tongue tissue was now tethered in the lateral retromolar and cheek area. Second disadvantage of tongue flaps when you use it for this purpose is it pulls back. No matter how you further forward pull it and put it at the angle of the mouth, next morning when you go on the rounds, the tongue flap has gone back to the retromolar fossa because the tongue is a very solid muscular organ and it pulls back the flap. Now I knew of a chap who sent a stainless steel wire through. So when you fail, you go and ask, यार आपने बताया था टंग फ्लैप करो मैं तो टंग फ्लैप कर रहा हूँ लेकिन जम नहीं रहा अरे मदन तू उसमें स्टेनलेस स्टील का वायर लगा दे ओके स्टेनलेस स्टील वायर सो थ्रू एंड थ्रू स्टेनलेस स्टील वायर इट स्टिल पुल्स बैक सो टंग फ्लैप हैज अ बिल्ट इन प्रॉब्लम ऑफ डिसार्थ्रिया पुलिंग बैक एंड हैविंग अ वेरी पुअर एंटीरियर रिच एंड क्रिएटिंग शेल्स सो आई गिव अप देन द नेसल एरिया राइट अंडर माय नोज अबाउट 35 किलोमीटर्स फ्रॉम वेयर आई लिव देयर इज अ गाय who vociferously advises even today the use of nasolabial flaps. And he says these nasolabial flaps are wonderful, they are locally available, you can even take them as much as you like. But only point where I would say, now I use them, is this condition, if I have to reconstruct the floor of the mouth in the quickest possible way with no free flap at all. See why? You learn by mistakes. With nasolabial flaps, look at this fish mouth deformity. And the trismus didn't open anyway because there are these nasolabial flaps lying. They're lying in the buccal sulcus. Where is the problem? Retromolar trigone. Have I done the right thing? No. Because the phagocytosis will take place in the retromolar area, you pull down the pterygoids, everything is lost. So tongue flaps are really mentioned, although I know that if you call tomorrow something from Vidarbha, where I come from, that guy will be singing song about tongue flaps, the nasolabial flaps. In fact, he has now conceded to my argument because we bump into each other, a very close friend of mine. I said, Madan, yaar, tu bolta sahi hai, itna maza nahi aa raha hai. And that is talking after 10 years. That's something to accept. Now, the palatal flap. Good flaps, they are locally available. We can rotate the palate almost. We can make an axial rotation and take a full 360 degree turn. Because they are based on greater palatine artery. You can disconnect it from the top, from the medial side, from the floor, and literally rotate like a car handle, 360 degrees, and bring it in the cheek. Good flaps, good back of flap, and in fact, they are available, but they are not always available. In case they are available, they are worth considering, particularly the one picture you see there, they sit so nicely and they have a good effect. That's early, that's immediate, and they are wonderful. They work very well. Now, that's how that's a pellet from there rotated axially and put into the cheek. They work very, very well. You can see they are two different patients, so it's not that they work only on an occasional case. Now, fat flap. Now, one of my senior colleagues in FHNO, when we were talking casually, he said, "Are itna kyun karne ka hai? Thoda buccal bag ko kheej lo." The skin or the mucosa doesn't like to grow in the crevices and the heels and the valleys because this fat has got two problems. Number one, it's almost liquid. Number two, it has got a vasculature which gets detached when you pull it down into the cheek. So all the capillaries which are supplied, this is not a dead tissue. It has got microcirculation. And when this is detached and the fat macrocirculation is disturbed, it dies. And the next day there is a chunk of flesh which is all bulky and dyed and necrotic mass over which the mucosa never grows. I have not done many cases, 19 cases only, is a very poor performer. I gave up. Now, very providentially, in 1986, just a year after I had come back, I bumped into Dr. A.R. Mehta from Mumbai, who was talking about oral cancers in Nagpur, and I saw him operating, and I saw him doing that huge flap when this of CM Mandible Dr. Sargasiyar was being operated, and the electric bulb, as I showed you, clicked here. That if that guy can use this mandibular mucocoriaceum to put into the cheek, why cannot I do that just for a non-malignant case and exactly raise the same flap? And that was the beginning of mandibular mucocoriaceal flap, and we continued to do that for almost 7 years, and then we renewed the technique, and I will tell you that. What's the advantage of this flap? It is local anesthesia can be used, available, good random blood supply, ideal thickness. You see, we don't want very thick flap here. We want very thinnish flap here, because otherwise the flap itself causes problem. So, very perfect tissue map. The only problem was that it has got a very limited anterior reach. It doesn't come further forward. And we published this in the IJLO in 94, and that's what it looks like. You raise the mandibular mucocoriaceum from the medial aspect of the mandible and put that across here into the raw area up to almost angle of the mouth. That is 1994. Then I got laser. Again, another bingo. I can do it. But I told you my indoor experience. I wasn't very excited about it. But at the same time, I thought, okay, I can use it. But all it has done, it has really substituted knife for most. So if you don't have a laser, don't lose heart. It is not mandatory. It only gives you a seeing knife access with a little bit of a less bleeding. But as it is, the bleeding in trismus surgery is minimal if you stick to the planes. It's a famous teaching from my teachers earlier days. Madan, if the bleeding is too much, you are in the wrong place. Because good Lord has created spaces and fibers and the layers which are avascular. Take advantage of them. Here the avascular plane is close to the mandible. If you stick just below the mandibular periosteum, there is no blood vessels. The bleeding will start if you get into the pterygoids or if you get into the cheek. If you stay put on the mandible below the periosteum, I show that there is no bleeding, so no great advantage. Of course, all other things. But it introduced me to a new technique, and that is the technique of two parallel cuts. Take one cut on the upper surface and one cut on the lower surface and spread this tissue out. And then that buys your insurance policy that between these two cuts, there is a healthy mucosa which is attached posteriorly to the tissue which is surviving. And then eventually, if the fibrosis does take place, you will not have lost much thing, at least gain few things. And this was the principle. But this was just the beginning. You do this, you sometimes end up with a very small thing, sometimes a fairly good thing, sometimes even a better thing. It only can get you from grade 2 to grade 3, or maybe grade 1 from grade 2 to grade 1. But it doesn't really work. Although it is an office procedure, it is shaped better than the indoor procedure of cutting a band, and probably does not violate my future options. So should I fail, I can go back and do something better next time. And that's the result. Now, I want you to introduce you to this concept of one jump, two jump and no jump. One jump, by that I mean that your results will get up by at least one from grade 4 to grade 3. Two jumps means you come from grade 4 into grade 2. And no jump means you don't get any better at all. If you look at it, I have got no two jumps here and no 26%, and almost one fourth of my patients didn't get better at all. So that was not a good thing. Is excessive and very, very difficult to maintain that. So we revisited the mandibular mucocoriaceal flap. If you look at the earlier picture, it was a great big flap coming right up to here, but the new flap now doesn't come up to here, but only stays in that area. Because I have changed my technique, which I will illustrate very shortly. So new flap doesn't come right up to here, but it only goes up to there. Now, how did that start? Because I thought that the less I do, see this is an early picture, this is a new picture, the less I do, the better I get. Ron Spiro from the famous book, and he quoted, where less means more on conservative surgery. Now what happened, that when I started doing the newer technique, my second jumps improved. I got some second jumps now, but this does not really improve. I am very honest and candid because I want you to work through with me, because nothing is gold standard yet. Now, another collaboration thing. This was A.R. Mehta, and the second meet was Professor Khanna from Mumbai. Professor Khanna, in his early days, was a great hero. I don't know how many of you know Professor Khanna, but a very flamboyant character. He's a party man. And as a junior resident doctor, anybody who took you to the coffee house and gave you a cup of coffee was a hero. And so he was a hero. But anyway, when I bumped into him, I said, Saab, to jab meri baat, abhi result barabar nahi aa raha. Then he said, you have forgotten about the corona. And therefore, we started doing corona. And I'll take you through the steps, because this is the thing which I have not seen any standard textbooks, and therefore needs a little bit of more elucidation. What you do is you have three bands. Band number one, band number two, band number three. Always. Whenever you examine, yesterday I saw that case with somebody, and if you remember, I demonstrated all these three bands. There are always one right here just behind the angle of the mouth, then one halfway through and one under coronary process. Now you take a Y cut and you get into here, but you cut this lower band not there, but down here. But address all these three bands very systematically with laser, because laser is a non-bleeding but seeing knife. It's a wonderful tool. I love it. And you cut it like this, and the change now occurs. Can you see this change happening? I'm only telling you what I'm doing now. I did a Y, I don't anymore do a Y, I just do there, vertical line, one cut here, one cut there. This cuts there, this band will be cut here, that band will be cut here. So therefore, I have now a laser cut. But this is the first step. And take this incision right behind the molar, right on the anterior pillar, and come back middle, come back towards the gutter in the floor side. And once you've done that, you will expose the coronary process. Now I mentioned a while ago, stay close to coronary. Close to coronary. Now I'm deliberately showing you these black spots here. Not deliberately, but I'm not feeling shy about showing you. These are the lesser hits on the coronary process. I don't mind this because I don't want to go out. So I literally keep on hitting the bone with the laser, and then the periosteum keeps pulled away on both sides. And there is a plane here and a plane here, and a wonderful instrument called dental elevators. You borrow them from the dentist and run them on either side and push the masseter back, push the pterygoids on this side, keep cutting in this area, and expose the entire length and the breadth and the height of the coronary process. Once you do that, it's a standard drill. You take a piece of the apex of the coronary, that's a coronary excision, and you then have a nicely polished off coronary process, and that's about how it should look. And then of course you take a mandibular recuperation, which you raise from the inside of the alveolus, and just small strip, not a big strip like before, and just stick it in that area. That cut to be ignored and this tape cut to be ignored. Just leave it here and plaster here nicely. Looks beautiful, same color almost. So almost gives me a guarantee that it's going to survive. And that's what it looks like. Now, something. This is an older side. No more rice tube. Because rice tube makes them little lazy. They don't swallow well. And they are filthy mouth the next day. Don't let them have rice tube. They swallow and their mouth is beautifully clean. Now, these are one of the things I realized, that how often have you asked your Christmas patient, and the main difficulty is, sabke saath baithke khana nahi kha sakte. Because they all develop tricks how to eat. Some will pull their cheeks out, some will put the food in the small pusher, and then they get the food inside. And therefore they can never eat with the family. These guys are happy because they can now eat with the family, go to the parties, go to the receptions, have a nice food with everybody else, and that's a big achievement for them. Even though this gentleman is not that brilliantly opened out, but at least he can eat in public. Now the darker side of the story, so far so good, but yet this gentleman ended up from there back to here. And therefore, what was going wrong now? We did everything right. We opened up the mouth, we did the coronoid, we released all the muscles, we got the mouth opening, four fingers on the table, we put a flap there, still we were not working. And that made me to discover this flap, or the lead, apply this flap into the mouth, and that is a platysma myocutaneous flap. It's a large flap, thin and supple, skin is very ideal, no hair in the lower part of the neck, and therefore the scar is also very remote. The scar comes in the just above the clavicle. Disadvantage is it's too big at times, and it can get bitten between the cheek. And the third lung is pretty much cheap. It is a problem of hematoma and sometimes detachment will show that. See, this is how it goes in, and this is how it looks like at the end of the day after several months. This is a flap which will go tucked under the mandible. This is what it looks like after several weeks. It becomes nice, supple, except for some shade of pigmentation. Otherwise, it looks almost like normal mucosa. That's what the scars are like back here. Now, this patient might be recognized by somebody in the audience here because this has come to me from Mumbai. This is an old operated CA oral cavity, condemned to zero mouth opening, and said, "Karsam jindagi mein koi matlab nahi. Agar main khana nahi kha sakta, agar main family se ja nahi sakta, to shayad ho sakta cancer mujhe utha leta." This patient survived for many years with that kind of a mouth opening because we ventured out to do this flap. It is a very rewarding procedure, even a little bit philosophically. Why should it actually get better? You can recognize that this is his mouth opening in the beginning. This is the scar of the platysma flap. This is the platysma flap scene. Actually, you can see this has got better. Why should it get better? It should get worse. And my only argument is the patient who strives harder and harder and the platysma atrophies, get detached from this attachment at the mandible, and that means that play. But for that, the patient has to be extremely motivated and wanted to have this kind of mouth opening at the end of the day. Look at the well-being of the patient. Much better now, because he eats much better now. Now, make and break factor is this. Yesterday, you must have been heard me talking that we have got a 50 rupees worth of a mouth opener. We have got 400 rupees worth of a screw. We have got 1200 rupees worth of a metal screw, or we got 12,000 rupees worth of a therabite. The choice is yours. But the principle is that they should keep on opening the mouth, and this is my own device. I make them do this. Two advantages. The patient is still in the hospital there. Is it a drama? Is it something I am trying to make very sort of emotive? And no. This is very essential. It's essential that the patients and the family knows that you have done a job, now up to him to maintain it. So you put the onus back on the patient. Maine toh mera kaam pura kar diya, ab aapko sambhalna hai. And that's what it makes. And then it works quite well. They do quite well. Now let's see the results. MMPF coronoid. Can you see something that the nil jump has come down to 8 and 6%? Two jumps have gone up to almost one-fourth of the patient. See now, we put coronoid into it, my zero result now. That means I have not succeeded, never happened. One jump at least guaranteed in two-thirds, but about this big number are getting more than two jumps. So this is very, very reassuring and relieving. And what the predictor factors are? Now, what really makes you succeed or not succeed is these two things. Coronoid to me and jaw stretching. If you do these two things nicely, you can be almost guaranteed for a good result. Now this is what we're doing, and this is the advantage of getting somebody from Tata into your fold, because they bring in a lot of statistics and a lot of analysis. And I owe this like to my son-in-law, trained by Rathamesh. He said, no, you can't do like that. You've got to analyze your result. So we put the results to the grind, and that's what they look now. And this is what we are about to talk in case we get accepted in the Western world. Now I walk with conviction in 2009. I almost rigidly framed myself, partly my age, maybe I'm getting older, I'm no more flexible like I was before, but more importantly, I got convinced. Anybody here has ever reminded of this? Now I talk with conviction, famous Vivekananda saying. Vivekananda said in Chicago in his first visit that I'm very proud and feel very privileged to be a Hindu and coming from India. He said the same thing in the second visit, 13 years later, I still say the same thing, but now there's a lot of conviction rather than sentiment. So now what I'm saying here is on the similar lines. I'm not saying that so much with sentiment, but I'm saying conviction that these are the things that work and when you are to what? Last slides. If it is grade 1, that means only I have got a submucous symptomatic fibrosis, I will do iron cuts even now. If I have got 2 grade, that means there is submucous fibrosis. Patient feels that he is not able to open the mouth nicely, but there are no symptoms of inability to eat publicly. There are no symptoms of weight loss or starvation, and therefore I am still happy to do this iron cuts sometimes, but I'll be happy to do a Saigon Y and mandibular mucopalatial cut without doing the coronarectomy. If you were grade 3, I will probably do a flap, and now I will do a coronary as well, because I know that this patient requires a big release. And grade 4, that means the patient comes with zero finger mouth opening, I will do a platysma. So this is where I say, and you can see these lines run through in all the slides, because that is the paramount importance. What I have not done so far, but pondered about it, was the free flaps. And I think it's too much for too little. When I'm succeeding with this much flaps, I have kept them in reserve, so maybe one day some other bright young surgeon might be coming or might be doing these flaps in 1 hour, 1.5 hours, and maybe that may be the thing to do. That may be the thing to do. Now, be a learner, because the final word is far from being said. I don't think, how many in the audience here can honestly raise their hands and say, we do trismus surgery? How many of you do it? 1, 2, 3, that's it. When all the hands will go up, then maybe that's the day when some consensus will come. Until then, it is Baba Vakyam Pramana. I said so it happens. But it should not be Baba Vakyam Pramana. He should be questioned, challenged, and he has to stand up to the truth and the test of time. Maybe it will, but until then, please keep on doing things which suits you and keep on challenging me, because I'm not that old really. I can still change. And lastly, my appeal to these guys who have not raised their hands. If you are a good surgeon, just don't look good, because ships are not built to stand in the harbor and look good. They're supposed to go in the rough sea and sustain the rough sea and travel through the seas. If you are a good surgeon, don't just look good doing small things. Take this beast by bull by the horn and try to tame it. Be a big, big time spaniel. The success awaits you.